Today, I'll be reading from Psalm 51 and some pretext for it. This is where the prophet Nathan confronts King David about his adulterous relationship with Bathsheba and the death of her husband because of that. So this is David coming to God after he's been confronted. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you and you alone I have sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore me to the joy of your salvation and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise, for you will not delight in sacrifices, or I would give one. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise.
A broken and contrite heart, God never despises.
Thank you.
Faith. Actually, God created humanity to have faith in something. A lot of people put their faith in their money or their job or their home, their family, their country. We all today are putting our faith in gravity. And you're putting your faith in those chairs, and we are putting our faith in the platform. But there is a big difference between putting faith in things that you can touch and see and handle, and putting faith in God, who you cannot touch and you cannot handle. And though you can see the effects he has upon his creation, we cannot yet see him. As Paul said, we look through life as through a dim and cloudy glass. But one day, we will see clearly. Until then, I urge you, regardless of what the world says, regardless of what the radio, the media, your neighbor, maybe your friend, says, put your faith in Christ alone.
Good to hear little voices, isn't it? Maybe not so much for Mom, but it's good for the rest of us to hear a little voice. Welcome this morning as we come to worship God today, and we've already been singing and praising his name. I have a few announcements to just touch base on. I know they're regular, but just want to make sure everybody's aware. We have a virtual Bible study growth group tonight at 6:30 as we continue our study in Revelation and looking at the churches. We're going to look at the last two churches that we hadn't looked at before. Celebrate Recovery every Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. Encourage you, if you're feeling stressed or you have some issues, that you would need a place just to come and be loved and help work on those issues, I would encourage you to come on out and be with us Tuesday evenings at 7. Our youth group, online or in person, Or you haven't made that decision yet. Okay. It'll be in person this week. So here at 6:30, again, youth group. Prayer meeting, of course, is every Thursday at 10 a.m. And there is a Google Meet code to get in, and you just need to dial that in on your computer, and that'll let you come join us at 10 o'clock. And now, as I've said before, if the meeting hasn't started quite yet, if you come early, it will depend on whether I've got to my pad or my pad yet to open up the meeting. So just sit there and wait. We'll get there by 10 normally. Wendell will tell you there's a few times it's probably been a little bit later than that. But by 10, we'll have that open. And that also goes, like the virtual growth group, you can usually join us by about 20 after or 25 after, because we're usually there at a quarter after 6, that meeting starts. Also, we're going to do men's breakfast. Of course, all the social distancing and stuff needs to take place and all that stuff. But come join us. We'll be looking at, I haven't yet decided exactly what the devotional will be for that day, but come. I know a lot of us just need to get out and have a chat, and so I would come and join us. I encourage you to, but I need to know if you're coming, okay? So if you can let me know, or if you're going to bring somebody, please let me know so we know how much food to have and how to set up for that event. Also, we are handing out postcards, as Olive has written on the back here. We're doing it again, and this is the postcard. And so we want to place one of these in all the mailboxes as we can. I mean, we only have 25 of them, 25,000, 2,500 of them. 25,000 would be great. Can you? But 2,500, I'll get the number out. So if you can do, even if it's just around your home or whatever, I know I have people who've already got them out and they've taken them on their walks. So if you go for a walk and you can do an area, but you need to let Olive know, and she'll let you know whether that area has been covered before. We don't just want them all to go to the same, you know, houses. That's what we're saying in that. So you need to talk to Olive, but there's lots of these. There, as I said, there's 2,500 to hand out, and we want to encourage you to take those around. Also, for Easter, the Missions Committee is taking up a special collection of food for the food bank in Niagara Falls that we've been helping out, and it's our way of just blessing them. So there's a list of stuff in your program there that they're looking for somewhere in there. Anyway, it's in your program. And I know Olive, if she hasn't yet mailed it out or emailed it, she will be emailed. She did, she said. So she will email it, all of those of you who are watching via the internet. And I think that's all the announcements that I have. I'm sure there are other ones that have been flashing by on the screen. Thank you. an interesting thing when you try to take a mask off and you're wearing a headset microphone. It, a lot of times wants to come with you, come to the microphone with a mask. Today we continue our series as we've been talking about in John, and as you've realized, as we come close to Easter, we're continuing to look at the book of John, and we're continuing to look at John's account, we will, of the Easter story, and of part of that as it's leading up to the Easter story. I want to look today at John chapter 5. We're going to look at verses 21 to 29, and they read this way. For just as the Father gives life to those he raises from the dead, so the Son gives life to anyone he wants. In addition, the Father judges no one. Instead, he has given the Son absolute authority to judge, so that everyone will honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Anyone who does not honor the Son is certainly not honoring the Father who sent him. I tell you the truth, those who listen to my message and believe in God who sent me have eternal life. They will never be condemned for their sins, but they have already passed from death into life. And I assure you that the time is coming, indeed, it's here now, when the dead will hear my voice, the voice of the Son of God, and those who listen will live. The Father has life in himself, and he has granted that same life-giving power to his Son, and he has given him authority to judge everyone, because he is the Son of Man. Don't be so surprised. Indeed, the time is coming when all the dead in their graves will hear the voice of God's Son, and they will rise again. Those who have done good will rise to experience eternal life, and those who have continued in evil will rise to experience judgment. Amen. Let's bow our heads in prayer this morning. Great Almighty God, as we approach your word today, this word that talks about our new life in Christ, Father, may we be open to the message that you want to teach us. For some here, it's an old message that they've heard many times, and yet they need to renew that message in their hearts. For others, they live out the message, and they're living out the message and teaching the message. And for others, they've never heard it before. Their ears have been blocked from hearing what you have to say. Father, today we pray that we would listen and we would hear the way you would have us to hear, that our lives might be changed through learning what Jesus has done for us. We just ask this in Jesus' precious name, and I pray again that the words that I speak, Father, that they would be your words. I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. The extravagance of resurrection. Have you ever thought about that? Have you ever thought about how extravagant, how beautiful it is that Easter happened, an awful long time ago? And it's tended to be a familiar story. I don't think there's really that many people who don't know the Easter story. They may find it hard to fathom something we don't see every day. We don't see resurrection every day, right? But then it's supposed to be a miracle, isn't it? And miracles are things that we don't see every day. But there's a danger, and I think there's more of it. There's a danger for us as believers. There's a danger of Easter is that it is so special and happened so long ago that we can ignore it. that, oh yeah, it's another holiday. Another holiday where maybe I eat lamb or maybe I get another turkey, like Christmas. We don't even seem to celebrate it as much as we celebrate Christmas. We don't seem to get that energy. The Bible says there is more to resurrection, though, than just Easter. A day is coming in the future, it says, when each of us will be raised. Should get a praise the Lord for that, you know. And a very special resurrection can even happen right now, today. Jesus gives life right now. Because if you don't know Jesus, then you are dead. All those people that you might be looking up to, movie stars or rich people, whatever that is, if they don't know Jesus, they are dead. And if you look closely into their lives, you know that they are dead and not alive. Jesus said, I tell you the truth, those who listen to my message and believe in God who sent me have eternal life. They will never be condemned for their sins, but they have already passed from death into life. Let that sink in, what he just said. Many Christians, and the more we go through this pandemic, the more I see it, many Christians hope they'll live for in heaven. But they aren't sure. And that's a shame. If you're sitting here today and you're not sure, oh, you should be. The Bible says that we can be certain because eternal life begins the moment we believe, the moment we put our trust and our faith in Jesus Christ. It's not some distant future. Salvation is not something we must wait for. Get that out of your head. But a present possession and joy. We possess it today if I've given my heart to Jesus. I possess salvation. Notice that it says, but they have already passed from death into life. That's in a past tense. Past. It's not passing. It's past. They have passed from death into life. We have crossed from death into life, if we were reading the King James. Being alive in Christ should give us this new perspective of life. Let me just read you this story from Festo Kimminger, and I probably screwed up his name. Doesn't matter. Well, it does to him, but doesn't matter to us. He was a bishop, a Christian bishop in Uganda, Africa, you know, when Idi Amin was terrorizing that country back in 1973. He tells the story of men in his church who were executed by a firing squad. And Festo, he tells what happened, and he says this: people were commanded to come to the stadium and witness the execution. It wasn't your choice, they were commanded to come. Death permeated the air as a silent crowd of 3,000 watched. I had permission from the authorities, he says, to speak to the men before they died, and two of my fellow ministers were with me. They brought the men in a truck and unloaded them. They were handcuffed and their feet were chained, so you can imagine what it looked like. The firing squad stood there at attention. And as we walked into the center of the stadium, I was wondering what to say. How do you give the gospel to doomed men who are probably seething with rage? We approached them from behind, and as they turned to look at us, what a sight. Their faces were all alight and an unmistakable glow of radiance. Before we could say something, one of them burst out, "Bishop, thank you for coming. I want to tell you, the day I was arrested In my prison cell, I asked the Lord Jesus to come into my heart, and he came in and he forgave all my sins. Heaven is now open, and there is nothing between me and my God. Please, please tell my wife and children that I am going to be with Jesus. Ask them to accept him into their lives as I did. And the other two men told similar stories exactly and excitedly raised their hands, and there was this rattling of their chains and their handcuffs. Just think of this sight. I felt that what I needed to do was to talk to the soldiers, Festo says, not to the condemned, so I translated what the man had said into a language the soldiers understood. The military men were standing there with their guns cocked and bewilderment on their face. They were so dumbfounded that they forgot to put the hoods over the men's faces. The three faced the firing squad standing close together, and they looked towards the people and began to wave the handcuffs and all, and the people waved back. Then the shots were fired, and the three were with Jesus. We stood in front of them, our own hearts throbbing with joy mingled with tears. It was a day never to be forgotten. I can believe that. Though dead, the men spoke loudly to all of the Kegzi district and beyond. There was an upsurge of life in Christ, which challenges death and defeats it. The next Sunday, I was preaching to a huge crowd in my hometown, in one of the men's hometown, and again, the feeling of death was over the congregation. But when I gave them the testimony of their man and how he died, they erupted in a great song of praise to Jesus. And many turned to the Lord that day and turned in that place. New life in Christ brings three new relationships into our life. A new relationship with God. Instead of a judge, he becomes our Father. Old sins are not held against us. Bible says they're taken as far as the east is from the west, that God will never look at them again. There is this special closeness and courage flows into our lives. That's the first thing, the new relationship with God. We can go on and on in that. A new relationship, the second thing is we have a new relationship with other people. Hatred should become love. Those that we hated, we should love them. We should want them to come to Jesus. It's a hard thing in this world. Sometimes I see a lot of Christians who write a lot of stuff, a lot of hatred, not realizing that that's what they're writing. They should be praying and falling on their knees for those that are dying without Christ. When we come to Jesus, we have that kind of relationship. Selfishness should become service. Not what's in it for me, but what can I do for you? Bitterness should become forgiveness. Forgiveness. One of the things we learn at Celebrate Recovery over and over again is that we need to forgive. Not only do we need to be forgiven, we also need to forgive those that have hurt us. Not carry that bitterness. Finally, we have a new relationship with ourselves. We are usually, you know, our own worst enemy, to be honest. Oh, we can blame, and I've heard lots of people in my pastoral ministry and before I was a pastor and other places, but lots of people like to blame everybody else. You know, the devil made me do it, as for those that remember Flip Wilson back in the day. I'm really dating myself now. Weakness, though, when I come to Christ becomes strength. Where I'm weak, he makes me strong. tensions becomes peace. Inward change, both sudden and gradual, start to take place. Old habits are conquered. New way of thinking starts to happen. And Jesus also gives life to us in the future, this passage tells us. In verse 25, "And I assure you that the time is coming, indeed it is here now, when the dead will hear my voice, the voice of the Son of God, and those who listen will live." 28 and 29 say this, "Don't be so surprised. Indeed, the time is coming when all the dead in their graves will hear the voice of God's Son, and they will rise again. Those who have done good will rise to experience eternal life, and those who have continued in evil will rise to experience judgment." Now you see, the Jews that he is talking to here believed in a literal future resurrection. Bodies of believers would come alive at the last day. They believed that. Go to the story of Lazarus and his sister Martha, and in there Jesus told her, in verses 23, 26, say, Jesus told her, "Your brother will rise again." And yes, Martha said, "He will rise when everyone else rises at the last day." She was, of course, thinking of the last day. And of course, Jesus told her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. Everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never, ever die." Did you get that? Everyone who lives in me, believes in me, will never, ever die. Do you believe this, Martha, is what he said. He could say that to you. Do you believe that? We will be resurrected just like he was on that first Easter morning. Therefore, Christians, we shouldn't fear death. We shouldn't be afraid to die or bitterly grieve when a loved one dies who knows Christ. You know, Winston Churchill is full of all kinds of things when you want to talk about a man of great speech and actually of great knowledge. But Winston Churchill had a plan his funeral, sounds about right, which took place at St. Paul's Cathedral. He included many of the great hymns of the church and used the eloquent Anglican liturgy for his funeral. At his direction, a bugler positioned high in the dome of St. Paul's intoned after the benediction the sound of taps, the universal signal that the day, that says the day is over. You can hear it. But then came the most dramatic turn. As Churchill instructed, as soon as taps was finished, another bugler placed on the other side of the church in the great dome played the notes of reveille. It's time to get up. It's time to get up. It's time to get up in the morning. That was Churchill's testimony that at the end of history, the last note will not be taps, but it will be reveille. People, it will be reveille. It's time to get up. We learn here that Jesus is the bringer of judgment. He talks about it in these verses. All humans will be resurrected. All of us will be resurrected. And they will rise, he says in verse 29, and they will rise again. Those who have done good will rise to experience eternal life, and those who have continued in evil will rise to experience judgment. So you know what that means, don't you? That both St. Peter and Hitler will rise. Now the difference is the destination of those resurrections afterwards, right? The destiny. A person's judgment depends on your reaction to Jesus. It's not enough to just believe in God. There are all kinds of people that believe in a God, in God. Verse 23 says this, so that everyone will honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Anyone who does not honor the Son is certainly not honoring the Father who sent him. So you can't believe in a God if you don't have Jesus. It's no good. You need Jesus. You need Jesus. We must honor the Son and believe in his words. What does listening to Jesus' words mean? Well, he says in 24, I tell you the truth, those who listen to my message and believe in God who sent me have eternal life. They will never be condemned for their sins, but they have already passed from death into life. If you believed in Jesus, you put your faith in Jesus, you've already passed from death to life. So what does listening to Jesus' words mean? It means to believe that God is as Jesus says he is. To accept the way of life that Jesus offers us, even if it's hard. And I'll be the first to tell you it's not easy. I know there's lots of preachers out there who want to say, come to Jesus and you'll have a picnic. You're going to be blessed. You're going to be a millionaire. You're going to have 10 airplanes like I do and all of that kind of stuff. That's just a bunch of lies. The majority of Christians in this world don't live that way. To accept the way of life that Jesus offers us is hard. To accept the help of Christ and the guidance of the Holy Spirit, that's what it means to believe in God's word. He gives this new life as a gift. It's not a wage. It's not something that we can earn. God help you if you're trying to earn salvation, because you can't. No way. You have to surrender your heart to him. He gives it abundantly. Just read the John 10:10. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. The thief, Satan. For those that think that there is a hell of a party going on in hell, there isn't any party going on in hell. Hell is total separation from God. And you think the pandemic has been hard? You just wait if you're on your way there to what hell is like. But it goes on to say, I have come that they may have life. Do you get that? Life. And that they may have it more abundantly. So the question to you today is, what will you do with Jesus? Those who first followed Jesus had their lives turned upside down. Peter went from this deserter to an evangelist, this fisherman to an evangelist. Religious opponents asked, who are these untutored men? Courage they had in the face of persecution. Remember, all except for John, and even John had terrible things happen to him, but all the apostles died horrible deaths. I mean, John, he lived to be an old age, but he was boiled in oil and different things like that. So it doesn't sound fun to me. The church spread, though, to every major Roman city in 200 years. Think about that. It wasn't that Rome said, oh, yeah, let's bring on the Christians. No, they were feeding them to the lions. They were persecuting them. New life is abundant. But I want to again emphasize, it's not always easy. You're not going to walk around always healthy, except spiritually. W.E. Sangster. He was a noted British minister back in the 50s. And in the mid-50s, he began to notice some uneasiness in his throat and a dragging in his legs. And when he went to the doctor, he found he had an incurable disease. The cause was progressive muscular atrophy is the word. Probably was Lou Gehrig's or something, I would imagine. His muscles would gradually waste away. His voice would become silent and his throat unable to swallow. Sangster threw himself into his work in the British Home Mission. He figured he could still write and he would have even more time for prayer. "Let me stay in the struggle, Lord," he pleaded. "I don't mind if I can no longer be a general, but let me just let me be a regiment lead. Lead a regiment." He wrote articles and books and helped organize prayer cells throughout England. "I'm only in kindergarten of suffering," he would say, as people pitied him. Gradually, Sangster's legs became useless. His voice went completely, but he could still hold a pen shakily. On Easter morning, just a few weeks before he died, he wrote a letter to his daughter. In it, he said this: "It is terrible to wake up on Easter morning and have no voice with which to shout, 'He is risen.' But," he wrote, "it would be still more terrible to have a voice and not want to shout, 'He is risen. He is risen.'" One of the great pictures that's implanted in my mind is my friend Don, who, when he was passing away, probably about 2 weeks before he died, I think it is, he's laying in his bed and he's singing, "It is well with my soul," while cancer is eating his body away, because he knew Jesus. Because he has life. These gentlemen had life. We could list thousands of people. The thing is, do you have Jesus? Because I know it's tough out there. I know it's stressful. I know wearing this mask is not fun. Don't ever believe that I think it's fun. It's something we need to do, at least at this point. But do you have Jesus? Because if you do, you can rest in him. Because you have life. Doesn't matter if we all drop dead tomorrow or today or in 2 seconds. If you have Jesus, we have life. Life for eternity. If you don't, then you might want to get on your knees right now and pray and ask Jesus into your heart. Surrender your life. Stop trying to do it on your own and surrender it all and follow his words. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Great Almighty God, it's so easy to come to Jesus, and yet we make it so, so difficult. I think of those soldiers or those men that are being executed, and even whatever those soldiers must have gone on in their eyes and heart, Lord, as these men are praising you and shouting as they're about to be shot. Oh, Lord, we look at our own comfortable situation here in Canada. We complain, you know, and we have it so good. Too good in some ways. We complain that we can't gather everybody for worship when there's a pandemic going on, and we know people that are not here this morning because they're self-isolating, taking the opportunity. Disease is real. And yes, there probably are people trying to use it for their own gain, but Father, we pray against that today. But Lord, we need you. And Lord, if there's someone in this room right today or watching us on the internet today, on Facebook, or watching us through YouTube or whatever next week, Father, I pray that they would take the opportunity right now to ask and invite Jesus Christ into their life. All they have to do is say, Lord, I'm a sinner. I know that I need you. And I know I don't know everything, but I know one thing. I need your son. I want eternal life. Show me the way, Lord. Bring me your peace. Bring me your love. Bring me from death into life. And for those that have already been brought from death into life, let our hearts be re-energized and refired as we think of this Easter to come, O Lord, and what Jesus has done for us. May it not just be old hat. May we not be just worried more about the roast, I don't know, turkey or lamb or whatever it is, or whatever vegetarian thing we might be eating, Father. But may we want to celebrate Jesus, our Savior, our Lord, and give thanks for what Christ has done for each and every one of us. Father, today, speak to our hearts, we pray, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. And now may the grace and the mercy and the love of our Lord Jesus Christ go with each and every one of you. Amen.